introduce Rhydwyn, who's a statistician working in New South Wales Open Data Group, with her talk, for Reusable R for automation, small area estimation, and legacy systems. Round of applause, please.
Hi. As I said, I'm Rhydwyn. I work for the Open Data Unit at New South Wales Health, which basically means that my job is to take what are often medical records or very private medical data and put them out in on the web in a way which is safe to share. I do this using R whenever I can, and I'm hopefully going to take you through a case study of a project that I worked on last year and try to show how R can work in a conservative environment, how it can integrate with other systems and support a kind of gentle move to open source software. So what do we mean when we say open health data? Well, obviously, or at least I hope obviously, we're not giving out people's medical records. So what we do is generally give out counts and rates per 100,000 and ratios and other derived figures. But in order for this to be useful, we want to give it out at the smallest area possible. And a lot of the areas and other breakdowns that people want, we can't support using kind of standard statistical methods. And a primary example of one, and the one that this example is based on, is council areas or local government areas. So I've got a quick quiz here. Who here has heard of R? Put your hands up. Okay, most of the room. Who here has written some R? About half the room, I'm surprised by that. And a lot of R? Who's written a package? Who's posted something to CRAN? Anything like that? Excellent. One person, I think. Okay, so I thought I'd start with an overview of what R is and what's kind of happening in the current community, how it's being developed. R was started in 93, and it's an open source implementation of S, which was the statistical software programming language developed by Bell Labs. R is really flexible, which is a good and bad thing. It's got efficient array processing. You've got the idea that if you can pass a integer, say have a function that takes an integer and returns a double, then you should be able to, without any extra work, pass pass a matrix of integers and get the correct matrix of doubles back. It's got functions as first class citizens, and it has four object systems. So there's some room for cleaning up. I want to give something which I didn't know until quite recently about R, and I've been programming in R for something on 10 years. Here are a short list of things that you can redefine in R. Multiplication, addition, braces, square brackets, round brackets, and assignment are all redefinable by users. Now, I'm not sure of a lot of sensible use cases for this. Now R is an implicit return language. So when you have a function that doesn't have a return statement, it will return the last thing that is mentioned. So you can redefine closing brace to occasionally add a small random number to the last thing and introduce randomness into any function that a person using that then writes. This is a great way to troll your friends and make things that are basically impossible to debug up until they work out that someone has redefined closing brace, which is probably something that they don't know you can do. And there's another really important reason why you don't want to do this. It slows R down. Every time the interpreter finds a brace, it has to check whether the brace does what it thinks it does or whether it's been redefined. So there are a bunch of projects that I'm going to quickly go through which are building off R, but trying to get it into a faster and more sensible language. The first of these is the Row project. It's a re-implementation of base R. It's currently about the same speed as R, with array processing about twice as fast. The developers for this think a 10 times speed up is possible, and it's going to be adopted by Google as their internal R. There is FastR, which is based on the Truffle framework, which I don't know a lot about. But an interesting thing about this, which means I'll probably be learning more about it, is that it offers zero overhead integration with Ruby, Java, JavaScript, and C, C++. And because R is a specialist language, it's not necessarily something you want to be spending all your time in. Having a couple of programming languages there that are great for systems and a couple of programming languages there which are great for web interfaces, I can see some really exciting things happening about breaking out. And if you know anything about the current moves to kind of clean up R, you probably know about Microsoft R Open. Microsoft 2 years ago acquired a company called Revolution Analytics, which was kind of Red Hat for R, and rebranded it as Microsoft R Open and Microsoft R Server. Microsoft R Open is GPL2, and Microsoft R Server is integrated with SQL Server, and they're aiming that at high-end businesses, finance people, people who are looking for very fast, big data projects. Now, as I said, I work in the New South Wales Open Data Group, which kind of means that they went to contract, got some contractors in, built a website, probably wasn't spec'd great, probably didn't get everything we wanted. And then they handed it over to some statisticians. And there's an interesting thing that happens when you give statisticians a website to manage. Something I would like to call things you shouldn't do in R, which we did. So, for example, when we got this first set up, there was no regression testing between our test environment and our production environment. So we wrote it in R. R Selenium is a package that allows you to make calls out to Selenium, so we use that to generate the all the web pages and then just check test to production, has it changed. The second thing that we are currently trying to do in R rather than have finished doing is a port of the PyJIRA library to R so that we can automatically update our JIRA tickets from R scripts when to say that new data is ready, stuff like that. If I ever do get that done, I'll open source it and I'll come back and give a lightning talk about that. And the third thing is that we had some content people come in and rewrite a lot of our stuff from the website, which was great. But unfortunately, our website text input doesn't have as much cleaning as it should, and they were pasting stuff directly out of Word, and we got a whole lot of unprintable characters all through all our content before it was realized that this had happened. So, wrote R to connect to the database, pull the data out, pull the text out, clean the text, and then push it back into the database. Now, if you'd given me any of these jobs as a and asked me which language to do it them in, I would not have said R. But I think it's interesting to say these things were reasonably painless. We were very able to do all of these things, and I think that it's worth looking at all the things you can do in R, not just the statistics, even if you don't necessarily want to. Okay, now to get onto my case study, I need to tell you a bit about New South Wales council districts. Now, if you've been following the news in New South Wales, you'll know that these numbers are out of date. These are all facts about New South Wales councils from 2015. There are currently New South Wales council mergers. There are currently lawsuits to try and stop New South Wales council mergers. Our approach has been that we are reporting data on the old boundaries until the new boundaries are settled. So, for our purposes, there have been no mergers. There are still 153 councils, population of about 7.5 million. I gave a version of this talk at the International R Conference last year, which was in California. So I put in that it turns out New South Wales is 20% bigger than Texas. We think of New South Wales as a fairly small state because we forget how big Australia is. In terms of anywhere else in the world, New South Wales is huge and really, really sparsely populated. Our councils range from 1,500 people to 300,000 people, and they range from six square kilometres in central Sydney to 93,000 square kilometres out in southwest New South Wales. I'm jealous of open data producers. And last year I came here, I did a mini conf talk, and I got some people asking, so why don't you just give us the data? And I know where that comes from, because a lot of open data stuff has been on low-hanging fruit, and amazing gains have been made in low-hanging fruit. People get data like train ID, route of train, time of train, and they make great little mobile apps that mean that I don't miss my trains anymore, or that I can find where a public toilet is, or that I can find out that there's a cool attraction that's just 500 meters that way, because we've got the data of all the parks. That's all excellent. I work with sensitive data. I want to show you a query that I could log into my work account and run. And I have been in the position to run queries like this in the past for legitimate business reasons. I can find out the names of all the people, and I didn't put address there, but we've got address data too, of people who tested positive for gonorrhea from a rectal swab. So we need to be really careful when we're releasing data. But we're not doing that. We're just doing crosstabs, right? We're just doing the numbers in a council. So we still have a couple of problems with that. The first one is that we need to avoid against difference queries. We need to make sure that you can't look up two similar things and get back to kind of single person numbers. And the other thing is that small numbers have their own privacy problems. Let's say you've got a council where three people gave birth. One of them has Hep B. Now, we report the rate of hepatitis B in pregnant people, so this is a real thing that we could report. So I've just given those three people, who are fairly easily identifiable because they're pushing prams at the moment, a 1 in 3 case of chance of being Hep B positive. But what if one of them is known to be a bit dodgy? What if one of them maybe had her kid younger than people think she should have? Maybe they ran with the wrong crowd. Then maybe, as far as that local community is concerned, we have identified that person as being Hep B positive. We want to avoid that. But there's another reason we don't want to release straight stats. Science is hard. A lot of the diseases we deal with are in the 1 in 1,000 per person per year to 1 in 10,000 per person per year. Now, the things we're talking about here are individual cancers, heart attacks, hip replacement surgery, all of these things. They're relatively rare things. So thinking again about what a 1 in 10,000 disease means for a council with 5,000 people in it, we get this kind of newspaper headline, 300% cancer increase cases. Now, you might go, well, journalists are terrible. And journalists might be terrible, but my boss doesn't want me to just say, well, journalists are terrible. But also, presenting that raw data, saying, oh yeah, we had a 300% increase on last year, is bad UX. I am employed rather than a DBA because of the value add I'm meant to be doing, so that I can sit between the numbers and people who aren't statisticians so that they can understand what's going on, because they're a local council worker who wants to know what health problems are really important in their community and what they need to be doing to fix them. And by the way, local councils are huge sites of public health action. Local swimming pools, local sports centres, having kids' days, having footpaths that are well maintained so that elderly people and disabled people feel safe walking to the shops and become less car dependent. These are huge drivers of public health action. So councils are really important for us to work with. If you want to see a good example of this, I love this one by Gelman, which is the places where you get the high rates of kidney cancer death and the places where you get the low rates of kidney cancer deaths. These maps are useless. They don't tell us anything about systematic risk levels. They tell us about the population. They tell us about where we get the outliers, because there aren't enough people. So, public service. Core of our infrastructure is SAS. Who here has heard of SAS? Almost everyone. Excellent. SAS is old. It started development in 63 and was first released in 76. And it shows it. It's a statistical scripting language with limited capabilities. It's got macros, not functions. So that's direct string replacement rather than a function call tree that you can actually look at. SAS can be set up to call R. Unfortunately, the way that our data server is set up at work doesn't allow for this. So everything I'm talking about, we're using the good old-fashioned data passing through the file system, unfortunately. So we now need to get into a bit of statistics to talk about what I actually did. This is a standard Poisson model. It's a statistical model you use when you've got counts over some denominator. Number of planes that were delayed at an airport in a day, number of people who got sick per thousand. Anything like that works for Poisson. But as I said, our numbers are too small for standard models, so we need something else. What we developed is based on one key idea. You're like your neighbours. If you've got a small local council, there's a good chance that other councils around it have similar rates of disease and similar risk factors. So we're going to borrow a bit of information from all our neighbours. So we have what I'm going to call a fancy Poisson model. This is called a generalised additive model, and the difference is that we've added in a smooth function of a variable as well as our standard linear combinations. And we can have as many smooth functions as we want. Who here likes Markov chains? I love Markov chains. They make excellent, fun Twitter bots. Now, the key thing about a Markov chain for our work is its forgetting principle. When you develop a Markov chain, it only looks back one string, one word or one phrase or one whatever your element you're using to pick the next word. It doesn't have a deeper look back. So it's only interested in the neighbor behind it. So we want to take Markov to the second dimension. We want a Markov random field. Now, this is New South Wales local councils as a network graph where each vertices is a council and each edge represents that these two councils are neighbours. And we're going to let that mesh flex, and we're going to let the smaller councils move more and the bigger councils move less. So what does that look like in R? We've got a model. It runs the count of disease against a smooth term, which is a Markov random field. That's the MRF, with our neighborhood graph being NB. It also has a smooth term for age group, so we're fitting for every five-year age group. It's a Poisson. It has a population offset of the. It has a population offset, and the weights are taken from the populations, and that's how we cause the higher level of flex in the smaller councils. Now, I said R was really good at array processing. So getting our point estimates look like this. Now, what we're getting out of this is a directly standardized rate, which is a epidemiological way of removing the impact of differing age groups from a medical thing. So the magical matrices here, which I haven't gone into because they're complex, basically do that weighted sum. So that gets us our point estimates. What about our credible intervals? Well, here's what it sounds like to a statistician. The lower and upper credible intervals for these synthetic directly age standardized rates are produced using simulation. A large number of replicate parameter sets are simulated from the posterior distribution of the parameters of the generalized additive model. These are combined in a weighted sum, again using weights from the Australian 2001 population, and the 2.5 and 97.5 percentiles are reported as the 95% credible interval. What the hell did that mean? Okay, so what we do, we create a multivariate normal distribution of our covariates of our model and our Bayesian covariance matrix, which is basically the amount of variation we expect in each of the covariates plus the way that we expect them to move together, the correlation between the covariates. So what we've got then is kind of 10,000 alternate universe models that could also have produced our data. We then run them through exactly the same process as we got the point estimates. So we get the point estimates of our 10,000 alternate universe models. Then we take that and we line them up and we take the percentile at 2.5% and the percentile at 97.5%. And what's in the middle? In the middle is where 95% of our values landed. This is the 95% credible interval. What about reusable research? When I talk to statisticians, I go on and on about being more like programmers, because I think that there's a lot that statisticians can learn from the open source world, from the computer science world. This project has a unit test suite. It has extensive in-code documentation. I built it using, as far as I know, the best practice of computer science. And we go on and on about this because there's far too much bad science that exists because we wrote bad scripts and we trusted the answers, and we need to learn not to trust ourselves, because statisticians are learning, like computer scientists have learned, that we are not smart enough to know that our code does what we think it does. We need tests, we need challenge to that. My goal is to not publish Growth in the Time of Debt. I don't know how many of you have heard of that paper, but there were two Harvard economists, Reinhart and Rogoff. They wrote this famous paper. It was used to justify austerity. A student was given a project to repeat their analysis, reanalyze the data, and get the same results. And he couldn't. And when they looked into it, it turned out that the original analysis had been done in Excel. And when I was at Archon, someone pointed out, look, Excel is the largest used statistical tool out there. We know this. And they didn't drag the formula the whole way down. They left out about a third of the countries. And the results of the paper were quite different when you included all the countries. And when I heard this story, I went, there but for the grace of God go I. I cannot put my hand on my heart and say that if you asked me to justify every single project I've done, I could. We need to get better, and R is allowing statisticians to think like programmers and to learn how to do what is software design well. We're really lucky. We had no choice but reusable research. We produce 150 indicators, probably more now, about 20 years of data. That's about 2,100 maps each year. We don't have time to write bad scripts. We need to get this into batch processing, and R allowed it to do that. We also want to avoid black boxes. The kind of models we're talking about are tricky. They don't converge sometimes. They don't play well. We have issues with our input data. Hadley Wickham, who is the guy who wrote TidyR and ggplot, is a huge person in the R community, said, models can never surprise you because they can never challenge their own assumptions. But images can. And so by having packages that can spit out nice web pages, nice sets of all the images of all the graphs we've produced, we have a quick way for the skilled people to look at the diagnostics, to understand what the models are doing, without spending all day running through logs. I'm going to run through quickly the images we produce, just as a kind of idea of what you could do. This is what we did. It might not suit yours. We have a before and after map. This one shows that we're getting smoothing, which is good. We want that. And we're getting smoothing in the sparsely populated small LGAs. The bottom two images are Greater Sydney and are basically untouched. And that's what we're looking for. We know that those councils are big enough that they shouldn't really change. But we know that the very low council and the very high council right next to each other in the southwestern corner are probably noise. We have a forest plot which shows credible intervals, the points, the New South Wales average, and also how significant and how significant each value is. This plot has turned up really useful at detecting data issues. Now, I'm going to tell you about a small, very beautiful part of the southeast highlands of New South Wales that I had not heard of until I looked at a forest plot. Nullica. It's a tiny community. And a couple of years ago, one of our data suppliers, who only give us a small amount of our data, so we hadn't picked this up when everything gets crunched in, started providing suburb null values as the string null, which our geocoder happily picked up and put them in Nullica. So it had a really high disease rate for a little while. We have a scatter plot of before and after trends. Comforting here is that, so the size of the dot is the size of the LGA. We see that the large dots are lying on the X equals Y line. They're not moving much. And that the small dots, those LGAs that are jumping about, are being moved more. And we have an age spline. So this is the effect of age in our model, because this will generally run it. If we run into convergence problems, it'll show up here. You might think all of those images are a lot to go through, and they are. You know, when we're doing a bulk upload, we might have 200 or 300 maps being produced. And yeah, it takes some time to go through them. But the point is that we get to use smart people where computers can't work. These algorithms can't tell when they're doing something silly, like, say, putting everyone in Nullica. Humans can. And this means that we get to use statisticians where we want to use statisticians, which is working out when this has gone wrong, working out that this is doing the right thing, and developing new tools, rather than in our old processes where people were spending a lot more time just getting the thing to work. What's left to do? So the next two projects that I'm working on, I've so far just talked about count data. We're going to be working on small area proportions. So when we say what percentage of pregnant women had this complication, that stops, your denominator stops being the population and starts being the number of samples. So we're going to implement a logistic GAM for that. And the other thing is small area life expectancy. Now, it turns out that life expectancy is a weighted sum of the number of deaths each year in each age group. So we're looking at using the same kind of thing where we do produce a special matrix to get a weighted sum, but this time we'll do it for population for deaths and a different weighted sum, and we should be able to get life expectancy. The public service is conservative. I don't think this is going to be a really challenging statement. You know, if anyone wants to jump up and tell me that they're disrupting everything, that would be great. There's no R on our data server. But getting R into the public servers has been, for our organization, a brilliant gateway drug. R is easy to install on Windows, and that is such an important thing when you're dealing Running a non-Windows OS is just not on the cards at the moment. If I can't run it on Windows, I can't convince my managers that it's worth doing. Packages. CRAN is amazing. Install.package just works 99% of the time. And the only cases where I found that it hasn't just worked for me, for other statisticians that I'm working with, for standard Windows setups, is when it's stuff like our Selenium, which is relying on other stuff, and it's the Selenium permissions that took the time. So I don't, you know, being a statistician, the two languages I've mainly worked in is R and Python, and packages make me afraid of deploying Python at work, because packaging in Python can be really hard, and it's not just me. I need to build systems that I can document that people with a very limited computer background can come in, get running, and not get frustrated. I'm in a position where I can do good, but I need to convince my management that it's good. And that, and easy is a huge part of that. And statisticians learn R at university. So you've, mostly when you're hiring statisticians, you've already got some skills there. And so once you've got someone who's scripting in R, you can say, hey, have you heard of the test that package? It does unit tests. Let's talk about unit tests. It's easy to install. Here's a couple of examples. Let's get going. Packaging is very easy to do through RStudio, which is a free IED. So you can say, hey, let's build packages so that you can give them to other people. You can step people into a software development mindset for statistics without the sharp learning curve at the start. Okay, questions?
All right.
Sorry, I'm getting new at this. Does anyone have questions at all? I can hand the microphone to. Excellent.
All right, so you mentioned the importance of reusable code, and I'm coming with the bias that all the data you are going to generate is probably going to end up on data.gov.au at some point. So you got the code, you got the output data, but the input data is still very private. So how can we rerun the code to check that we have the same data or something which has the same properties?
So you're right. The data is very private. We do have a mechanism for researchers to get access to our code, to our unit record files. If you don't want to get a job at the ministry, then the process for that is that we consider any work that uses unit record files medical research. We have a medical research ethics committee, which you would go to, and on the basis of their approval, we will supply data on a cost recovery basis. If it's linked data, we do that through Cheryl. If it's non-linked data, we do that through the Ministry of Health.
You mentioned RStudio. What's your feelings about users relying on RStudio and so they have a point and click GUI, but then not being able to you write scripts so that it's more difficult for them then to pick up reproducible research and things like that?
I've never seen anyone use RStudio as a point and click GUI. I think that that would be quite difficult. I think that while RStudio does make some of the bits of, say, packaging easier, it does it in a fairly transparent way. You hit create package and you get a bunch of folders with a bunch of text files that you can look at and see that they are standard configuration files and look up how to edit them. So I don't think there's a lot of loss in there. I know that there are some other products which try to make R more point and click, but I don't think R Studio is really one of them. For those products, if I was going to suggest one, and it's not something that I know much about, I would strongly recommend someone, if they're looking at learning through one of those, find one that gives you a history tab. So find one that makes it really easy for you to see the commands that you would have typed to kind of say, so that you can sort of move slowly.
All right, I think that's the end of our time. And everyone, please give a hand to Rhydwyn for a great talk. And appreciation, thank you.